Welcome back. Centam Investment Group Services Division has been shut down and employees sent home as part of its cost-cutting plan. A story by the Business Daily on Friday last week had the CEO confirming the closure of the unit and indicated that all the affected employees would be fairly remunerated. He further explained that the move was at Centam's cost-cutting venture, which saw Centam Business Solutions, CBS, devolved to its subsidiaries. In what he said would free up 150 million in operating costs. Now, some of the functions of the CBS transfer to other units include Centam listed finance, tax, legal, internal audit, risk management, information technology, and company secretarial. Now, Centam has been restructuring its operations to enable its subsidiaries to borrow on their own without relying on the parent company to arrange or guarantee their obligations. Let's look at Centam's first 6 months of the year performance report, and we can actually see that loss after tax was 1.3 billion, and the operating loss, we could actually put it at 1.8 billion as well, crossing over to the next part as well. If you look at that profitability trend all the way from 2017 to 2020 has been profitable, but we do know that the biggest one was in 2017, but 2020 also, we do know that the profits behind that margin were because of some of the assets that Centam had to offload from its portfolio as well. Now, looking at where it is, trading loss is the one that coming in second in terms of that exposure at 529 million and loss from Two Rivers, a development group at 1.8 billion, and we've already said that have plans to also dispose that off as they lessen that real estate holding from the current more than 60% to just 55%, which they've said is their target. All right, George, 150 million. How significant is that in terms of the operating costs for Centam?
Elijah, if you look at Centam performance over the last few years, Centam has been a strong performer.
Yes.
Over the last few years. But come 2021, you've seen them making a big loss, so to speak. That is a substantial loss. 1.3 billion is not a small amount of money. And I think that informs the requirement to restructure their operations. And by restructuring, I think one of the areas that they wanted to look at is the CBS, so that they can avoid that cost altogether.
Yes.
Plowing back 150 million, Elijah, back to business for 1 year is significant amount of savings, so to speak. And I think that notwithstanding, the major reasoning behind that restructuring is to ensure that each subsidiary stands on their own, so that we can have fair values of each subsidiary of the Centam Investment Group. Remember, the model that Centam has built over the years is that they acquire a company, build it over some time, and then sell it at a profit, so to speak. That has been their driving model for some time now. I think this restructuring is just a way of ensuring that most of the subsidiaries, or they can fairly value the subsidiaries at any given time, so that they know when to acquire and when to dispose. When you have a centralized management system, then you cannot fairly value some of these subsidiaries, know which subsidiary is making money for the group and which subsidiary is not making money for the group, so that you can know when to dispose of any particular subsidiary. So in my view, Elijah, I think this is a good move, given their operating environment and given their model over the years, so that they can, at any given time, they can look at all these procedures and see how best each and every company within the group is performing. So I think this is laudable.
Yes.
Coming at a time,
yes,
like this, Elijah, where most companies are struggling, Elijah, you would want to minimize your costs as much as possible. And I think that is a strategy that every company across in that space would be looking to adopt. That is cost minimization and revenue maximization, Elijah.
But would you also tie this to their drive to also sort of rack up the valuation of the share on the local books?
Definitely, definitely, Elijah. You see, some of these companies are they get private investors or private placements to get funds to invest in some of these companies. And therefore, for you to fairly value every company, then you need to recognize their revenue, the revenues that that particular company enjoys. So the revenue that this particular company can generate vis-a-vis the expenses that are attributable to that company without looking at the overall overall group. So I think in my view, this is a strategy to at least have a fair value of each and every company within the group, so that when they go for either a rights issue or they go for a private placement, then they can clearly state that this is the fair value of each and every share of each and every company within the Centum group. So yes. One, it is meant to recognize the fair values of shares in each and every company, and also for future investment attraction, it is important that we value or we look at each company as a separate entity, despite being part of the larger group.
Pretty much. George, let's move on to the last one, where details have now emerged on how the Treasury Office spent $14.6 billion to stabilize petroleum prices, fight the effects of the drought, and conduct security operations in what was additional budgetary spending without the approval of the National House. Of the 14.6 billion withdrawn, 3.59 billion went to development expenditure, while 11.03 billion was spent on recovery expenditure, with 7 billion going to the fuel subsidy, 2.1 billion went to drought emergency, and 2 billion for expansion of Nairobi Eastern Bypass into a dual carriageway. Now, Article 223 of the Constitution allows the national government to spend money that has not been appropriated by Parliament if the money has been withdrawn from the contingencies fund, but still needs to seek the approval of Parliament for any spending within 2 months after the first withdrawal of the money. Now, in a twist of events, George, Treasury, through documents tabled in Parliament Thursday, is now seeking the approval of the House to regularize the expenditure of the 14.6 billion, with the documents indicating that the 7 billion was withdrawn from the Ministry of Petroleum and Energy. That's fine. Let's look at that levy again this morning, so we can actually see where we are in terms of that expansion. We do know that while the committee on delegation wants that taken out, the 5 shillings and 40 cents, but we need to see what happens. But then, George, you and I spoke about this levy, and then you said that the biggest worry that you had, that the intentions were good, but then that some of these monies was at the mercy of this Treasury official, who were going to misprioritize it. And they have, George. Should they be prosecuted?
Elijah, this is something that I think we've discussed with you. Some of these levies that the government imposes.
Yes.
We have the road development levy. We have this stabilization levy. We have the tourism levy. If you look at the laws that go into establishment of some of these levies, they are noble. The way they're meant to cushion the citizenry, or they're meant to cushion the business persons who are operating in that environment, so that there are no serious shocks in the market as they come into play.
Yes.
The challenge that we had, Elijah, with our government is that once this money has been collected and it is in a pool, then the way it is applied is normally a problem, larger. That is something that I would really still emphasize, that we have a problem with implementation or with the utilization of some of these funds. If a fund like, for example, this one has been set aside to stabilize petroleum products, let it remain for that particular purpose without being diverted into A, B, or C. For this particular case, Elijah, though Treasury is not legally wrong, Elijah, in applying these funds to other avenues, because PFM Act, that's the Public Finance Management Act, allows them to utilize some of these funds for any other eventualities that they come across with the approval of Parliament or they must get the approval of Parliament 14 days after, I mean, for 14 days after they have done these funds. But you see, Elijah, the intention of this fund was to cushion the citizenry from the serious spikes of petroleum products, that which we have seen over the recent past. So if you hear that these funds were misallocated or were allocated to other things other than what it was meant for, then it begs the question, what is the essence or what is the use of this fund in the first place? That tells you that whenever we have some of these levies, whenever we have some of these funds, then it shows that Treasury has the leeway to apply these funds wherever way they want to apply them. That is that is a misnomer, Elijah, if you look at it. The second bit is,
yes,
but if you look at the application of this 14.6 billion, only 3.9 billion went to development expenditure. The rest went to recurrent expenditure. And Elijah, the way government sometimes camouflages its inefficiencies is to just say that X amount of money went into recurrent expenditure. Recurrent expenditure meaning the day-to-day consumption or the day-to-day expenditures in a particular ministry. So you cannot pinpoint what this fund eventually did in the economy. And that is where the problem lies. So as it is, I know Treasury legally they're not wrong in applying that those funds the way that they did. But morally it is wrong, Elijah. We have put this fund across because we know that petroleum product is a significant product in the economy, and it determines the inflation rates, the cost of living in our economic setup, so to speak. So that is why Parliament, in its wisdom, decided that let us put out a fund there that can be used to stabilize serious spikes or any shocks in this space or in the petroleum subsector. But if you realize that this fund has been misallocated, Elijah, and then at the point where we need now to utilize this fund to address that particular issue, we don't have that. Therefore, the citizens must still start bear the burden again. Then it beats logic, Elijah. That is my beef with Treasury. So I think going forward, Elijah, I think Parliament should sit down and just crack the whip and say that if a fund has been meant for this, for A, let it be for that particular purpose without being diverted to do X, Y, or Z functions. And most specifically, for recurrent expenditure, Elijah.
Pretty much. George, let me pick your final sentiments, especially since we're talking about this issue. We do know that Fred Matiang'i was part of an interministerial committee that was selected by the president to come up with a raft of measures that we're going to see the country start paying cheaper for fuel and power in this country, but specifically on the fuel area. Do you believe that indeed we have a local solution to considerably bring the cost of fuel in this country lower than it is right now?
Elijah, let me put it this way. Managing our cost of energy is very critical.
Yes.
It's something that we must do if we are to realize that all agenda form. The thinking is right, Elijah. There are papers that have been done, and those issues are not rocket science, Elijah. If you look at the energy subsector, I know we have a problem with the way we pay our independent power producers. Something that each and every person in the ministry knows, Elijah, and if they want to address it today, Elijah, they will be able to address it.
Yes.
Our petroleum product, Elijah. If you look at the pricing of a liter of petrol, Elijah, then you can see that most of those levies go into government, and the items that the government just by a stroke of a pen, the president can say wave this, and we'll be able to bring down the cost of petrol and cost of energy down substantially. The only challenge we have here is that we have serious cartels at the ministry who wants to benefit hugely from some of this price management. That is why, Elijah, was very much opposed to price controls in our setup, because a few individuals in the ministry or their cohorts would want to use those legal bottlenecks able to benefit from some of this legislations, Elijah. So I would have wished that the nobility with which these legislations are passed in Parliament, the nobility with which these legislations are passed through Parliament and eventually assented to into bills should be the nobility with which they are implemented. We have very good thought processes. We have very good papers that have been presented. We have very good laws that have been signed into law. But the challenge we've always had is in implementation. There are few persons or there are few people who want to profit from these legislations, and they are the highest echelons, Elijah, of the ministry and of the government. That is where the problem lies, and that is what the government should deal with.
Pretty much. George, thank you very much for taking your time this morning to speak to us here at Metropole Television.
Thank you. Thank you, Elijah.
Anytime. Take him back. And the rest of the guests that we had this morning on our economic review at Metropole Television. Of course, your social media platforms. I am at Kenya Gesemba. We'll see you later for Metropole News. Good morning.